Our scripture reading for today is found in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 18. I shall read the first four verses. At that time, the disciples came to Jesus and asked, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a little child and had him stand among them. And he said, "I tell you the truth. Unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Therefore, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." It's a blessing and at the same time a lot of fun to be around children. Just a couple days ago, I had the privilege of being with my five grandchildren for a few days. I enjoyed their energy, their exuberance, their joy, their enthusiasm, and their excitement. While they were at home, they were watching a video of the wedding of my niece that happened in Florida a decade ago. And as you know, the wedding service concludes with the officiating minister telling the groom that he may kiss his bride. At that moment, my four-year-old grandson covered his eyes with his hands and said, "I wasn't watching." It's a lot of fun to be around children. Jesus invited little children to come to him. He held them in his arms, he let them sit on his knees, and he prayed for them and blessed them. The important thing for us to notice is that Jesus never viewed children as an annoyance or a nuisance. He never considered children to be unworthy of his time and attention. On several occasions, Jesus held up children as an example of faith, as illustrations of how we must approach God if we want to enter the kingdom of heaven. Although we adults are responsible for teaching our children and passing on the Christian faith to them, Jesus tells us that there are some lessons that we can learn from them as well. Yes, we teach our children many things, but Jesus tells us that we can learn a few lessons from them as well. As we grow and develop in our faith, we become more like little children. The mature Christian becomes more childlike. In fact, Jesus says, "Unless you become like little children, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven." In today's scripture lesson, we discovered how, when on one occasion the disciples asked Jesus, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" He called a little child, made him stand among them, and said, "Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven." In Mark, the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 14, 16, Jesus became upset when he noticed his disciples were chasing away some mothers who wanted to bring their children to him in order to be blessed. Jesus sternly rebuked his disciples and said, "Let these little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Jesus not only rebuked his disciples, he also contradicted their assumptions. The disciples had thought that power, authority, and influence were the things that mattered the most. Well, in this world, these are the things that men considered of utmost importance: power, authority, and influence. But Jesus made it very clear to his disciples that those whose goal in life is to be served and obeyed by others are the type of people who will be excluded from the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are like little children, humble, unpretentious, and unassuming. Why do you think Jesus held up children as the model of humility? Is it because of their moral purity, the fact that they haven't lived long enough to be polluted by this sinful world? I don't think so, because we cannot return to childhood. Jesus viewed children as the models of humility because they have no illusion of being in control. Children don't think that they have much power to exercise. They're always surrounded by adults who are taller, bigger, and stronger than they. Someone has to tell children when to get ready for school. Somebody has to decide what they're going to eat for dinner. Somebody has to decide whether they can watch the new Harry Potter movie. Children are not in control of things, and they know it. So Jesus held up the children as models of humility because they have no illusion of being in control. We adults are also in the same position as our children, except we don't know it. There are many social, political, and economic forces at work over which we have little or no control. Let me give you a few examples. The chairman of the Federal Reserve decides what interest rate you will pay on any mortgage. Your children's education is affected to a large degree by the State Board of Education. The State Board of Education decides which textbooks will be used in schools. Your health and the medical treatments that you receive are regulated to a large extent by the rules of Medicare and Medicaid. So our options are really limited. We strive for power, authority, and influence, thinking that these are the things that matter the most, when in fact they are of no significance in the kingdom of God. Any power that we may have is only temporary. Any authority that we may exercise is a derived authority. That is to say, it comes from God, and it can be revoked by God whenever He pleases. There's a common saying that says, man proposes, but God disposes, and This is very true. When Jesus was brought before Pilate, the governor of Judea, to answer the accusations that the Jewish leaders had made against him, Jesus refused to answer. In the Gospel of John, chapter 19, verses 10 and 11, we see that Pilate, the governor, became infuriated. And he told Jesus, "Don't you realize that I have the power to either free you or crucify you? Why don't you answer me? This is your chance. If you can convince me you're innocent, I can free you, or else you'll be crucified." And Jesus answered, "You have no power over me except that which is given you from above." In other words, Jesus was saying, Pilate, you are the governor of Judea, but your power is not derived from the Roman Empire. Your power doesn't come from the legions of soldiers standing at your command. Your power doesn't come from your office, from your title, from your wealth, from your ancestry. The power that you are exercising now is given you from above, from God, and He can take it back. In James chapter 4, verses 13 and 16, the apostle says, "Now listen, you who say, 'Tomorrow we will go to such a city, reside there for a year, conduct some business and make money,' but you don't know what will happen tomorrow. Your life is like a mist that appears for a while and then vanishes. Instead, you should say, 'If God wills, we will live and do this and do that.'" So making statements about the future as if we could personally guarantee that everything we said would happen is the opposite of humility. We depend on God for almost everything. Of course, there's nothing wrong with planning. There's nothing wrong with setting goals and working hard to achieve them. But our success ultimately is in God's hands. There's an English poem that has a Latin title. This poem is written by William Ernest Henley, and it's entitled Invictus. Now, the title is Latin, I believe it means invincible, but there's one line that I want you to think about. There's one line that says, "I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul. I am the master of my fate. I am the captain of my soul." These words may seem heroic, but they're not true. None of us is the master of his or her fate. Jesus is the captain of our soul. We sing, "Jesus, Savior, pilot me." We need his guidance all the time. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5, the apostle says, "God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble." And in Luke chapter 14, verse 11, Jesus says, "Everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted." Christianity is not about what we can give to God or what we can do for God. Christianity is about what God desires to give us and do for us. You may object and say, "Aren't we supposed to work hard? Aren't we supposed to give ourselves fully to the Lord's work?" Yes, but I want you to realize that all our giving is first an act of receiving. All our giving is first an act of receiving. You want to dedicate your life to God? Well, who gave you your life? You want to serve God? Yeah, who gave you health, strength, and your abilities? So our life, our health, our strength, our talents, our abilities all come from God. Whatever we give God, we have received it from Him in the first place. So we give to God what He has, we return to God what He has given us. Whenever we serve Him in any way, we are returning to Him what He has given us. God does not need us to serve Him. But God invites us to serve Him because He wants to bless us. And He knows the only way for us to grow spiritually is through the avenue of unselfish service. May the Lord give us the willingness to humble ourselves and be like the little children in order to be able to approach Him in the right way and become eligible to enter the kingdom of heaven.